job. First and 10 for Furman. Test, 1-2-3, test, 1-2-3. Well, 37 left to play. We're in the first quarter from Paladin Stadium in Greenville. The Furman Paladins and the Western Carolina Catamounts. A big rivalry between these two. Apologize for the technical difficulties we have experienced with our audio portion of the broadcast. Luckily, you've had the video for most of the game, and so you pretty much know what's happened. Western Carolina, three downs and out. Furman picks up a big first down on their first possession with a pass from Frankie DeBus to George Quarrel. Now, Furman going downfield. They hit their man. Keith Swilling, the tight end from Frankie DeBus, and DeBus is 2 of 3 on the day passing the football. Safety, Toussaint Kennedy and Terrell Wagner, the left side cornerback, are in there to make the stop. It's first and 10 for the Furman Paladins. Let's give you a rundown of the Furman offense. It'll be Frankie DeBus, the quarterback, Dwight Sterling and Bobby Doherty, the starters in the backfield. Receivers, George Quarles and Ted Stevens. Keith Swilling, who caught that pass, is the tight end. The offensive line after this play. Up the middle they go. This is the reserve fullback, Billy Stockdale, a sophomore, 5'9", 209 on the carry, and he just pounds it right up the middle, inside the 35-yard line, down to about the 32. The offensive line, you see those are the backs and the receivers for Furman, DeBunt, Sterling, Doherty, Quarles, Swilling, and Stephen, Patterson, Adams, Dugan, Bailey, and Cowan. The offensive line, to be totally honest, three of those performers could be all-conference this year. Backs in the eye for Furman. Here comes the option that they are so well known for. Doherty puts his head down and gets near the 20. First down, Furman, and they're doing it on the ground, Kendall, and that's what we knew Furman had to do against Western Carolina.
Well, if you can beat Western Carolina on the ground, you're going to have an easy day because they've only got three defensive backs. That time they got around the all-conference end. Geno Seegers and Bobby Doherty was able to gain a large chunk of real estate.
11:02 left to play. First quarter, Furman on a drive with their first possession. DeBus, number 22, steps to the line. That defense of Western Carolina is a ferocious one, a 4-4. Here goes Sterling playing fullback today. He'll pick up about three. David Johnson, the linebacker, and tackle Scotty Arant making the stop. Let's take a look at the starting lineup defensively for Western Carolina. Across the front line, James Morris and Geno Seegers are the defensive ends. The tackle, Scotty Arant and Derek Harrison. The outside linebackers, Craig Williamson and Cedric Lee, David Johnson and Kel Helm are the inside backers. The corners, Darrell Wagner and Ricky Garden. Toussaint Kennedy is the lone safety man. Here comes the option to the left side. Keeping is DeBus. He's inside the 10. He's got a first down. Those are the defensive backs for Western Carolina. Wagner, Garden, and Toussaint Kennedy. Kendall, he leads the team in tackles, and he's the safety man.
Well, that tells you something about this defense. Although it would seem to indicate that a lot of people are getting into their secondary, they play an aggressive run-stuffing type of defense. And they've now moved Scotty Arant back to his natural position of defensive tackle. So apparently they want to try to stop Furman right now while they have a chance.
.57 to play. DeBus tries to go right side this time, and not this time. Making the stop, number 98, Derek Harrison, the junior tackle.
Derek Harrison, 6'2", 242. He's a junior out of Greenville, South Carolina. He's a man who they've come to depend on over the last couple of years to provide adequate fill-ins from game to game. Now he's a starter, and he's playing well this year.
No score, but Furman on a drive. They've got the ball set squarely in the middle for their field goal kicker, should they need it. DeBus wants the throw in the pocket. He fires, he's got his man. Touchdown, Greg King, the tight end.
And I'm telling you, it's wide open, Steve. They haven't touched him all day unless he's run the ball to them. And in order to beat Furman with the 4-4-3, they're going to have to get in his face. Seegers, Arant, and Steve Morris, they're going to have to get in Frankie DeBus' face.
For Key, that's his second touchdown catch of the year. And it gives Furman a lead of 6-0.
That was remarkably easy drive. They just took the ball and just marched right down the field.
Western Carolina has zapped Furman three straight times at home. to snap that streak, and they want to snap it today. Wood on to attempt the extra point. Mike Wood. Kick on the way, and the kick is good. Furman with a 7-0 lead. 10-play drive, 75 yards, and Furman has a 7-0 lead. Kendall Lewis, Pete Butler with you from Paladin Stadium in Greenville. Again, apologizing for our technical difficulties earlier. I think you hit the nail on the head. That drive was extremely easy against the Western Carolina defense, Kendall.
A lot of it was done on the ground, and Western Carolina has a defense that's situated and set up to be able to stop teams against the run. If they can't stop Furman, they're in for a long day because, as we've seen, Frankie DeBusk is not being tight. So they're going to have to get their defense together so they can get in somebody's face, stop the run, try to stop the pass.
Furman will kick off to Western Carolina again. Second time today, Otis Washington is back deep to receive for Western, and there is number 40, Glenn Conley, preparing to kick off. The Paladins come into this one 5-2 with a 2-1 mark in the Southern Conference. Western Carolina is 2-5 and 1-2 in league play. The Paladins are ranked number 10 in 1AA.
You know, see, one interesting thing about this game is the team that usually gets the most offensive yardage is the team that loses 4 in the last 5 games. So, Furman should watch out for that as the ball falls off the tee.
Must be something in the way Glenn sets that football up, because for the last 3 times we've watched Furman play, Conley has had the ball blow off the tee. Good to be back with you after a 3-week hiatus, a couple of games on the road, and an open date for the Paladins. But now we're back at beautiful Paladin Stadium on a gorgeous fall afternoon. Kickoff is high. It'll be taken by Washington inside the 10. Up to the 25, maybe the 26, where Western Carolina will start 1st and 10. Well, Western Carolina, a couple of runs, an incomplete pass on their first possession. Let's take a look at their offense. Todd Cottrell, the quarterback, there was some question as to whether he would start today. David Jones, Carlton Terry, Otis Washington, Robert Baxter, and Andy Schultz are the receivers. We'll go to the offensive line right after this, but here's Western Carolina with a 1st and 10. This is Terry. Got a little hole, and he's out across the 30. They'll spot him at the 33-yard line. Pretty good gain on first down by Carlton Terry, the sophomore from Conway, South Carolina. There's the offensive line. Del Smith, Lee Smith, Del Foster, Lee Smith, Jay Mulwee, he's a veteran, Tony Garagiola, and John Martin.
This isn't a very deep team, especially on the offensive line, but they carved out a nice hole that time, picked up about 8 yards.
Second down and a short 3. They've got to get just across the 35 for a 1st down. Terry again, short of the 35. It'll bring up a 3rd down and short yardage to go. Jeff Blankenship making the stop, one of the Furman linebackers. There's a look at the Paladin defensive line, which has played so well this year. Kelly Fletcher leads the Southern Conference with 9 quarterback sacks. Brian Pitts at tackle, Wayne Burr the nose guard, Craven the tackle, and Chris Roper the other defensive end. Blankenship and Kendrick, 1 and 3 respectively in tackles in the Southern Conference. Defensive backs in just a moment. 3rd down and less than a yard for Western Carolina from the 34-yard line, Catamount territory. They try Terry. He's wrapped up in the backfield. He doesn't make it. He didn't even get to the 35-yard line. No, Paul Craven, Jeff Blankenship there to make the stop.
And you know, that was a graphic illustration of what we've been saying. They would prefer to get into a passing game with the Paladins. Paladins would prefer to keep them in the running game because they don't have a great offensive line. And if they can give Cottrell time, then they might pick them apart. So we want to keep them in a game where they have to run at us.
And I'm surprised they've run the ball as much as they have in their first 2 series. They've only really tried to come out and throw the ball 1 time. 7:19 left to play. 1st quarter, 7-0 Furman lead. Low, spiraling kick taken by Pat Turner at the 20. 25, still on his feet. To the 29, that's where Furman will have it. Gutsy little return there by Turner. Now, Bobby Doherty returned the first punt. And I haven't looked out to see if he was hurt. Maybe they're going to alternate returning the punts, but Bobby Doherty returned that first kick. And it's ironic that if he was hurt, that 2 years ago it was in this game against Western Carolina that he received a serious knee injury where he had to be redshirted for a year and a half.
Well, you know, Pete, they say fate is cruel, but I hope it isn't that cruel.
We'll look down and see if we can find number 20 on the sideline. Here comes from DeBusca on the run. He keeps it. He takes it upfield to the 40, 45 midfield, and what a dive for more yardage by DeBusca. Into Western Carolina territory before safety Tucson Kennedy can make the stop. First down, Furman.
Again, it's very interesting that the runs start on the left side of the Furman offense, where Geno Seeger, Scotty Aran are. They take the ball, they run off tackle, and they're picking up huge, huge chunks of yardage. They're not supposed to be able to do that against the head, but as we know, they have superior strength, especially on the offensive line.
There's a look at the officials for today's game, and a look at Frankie DeBusca. Very instrumental in that big win over Appalachian State a couple of weeks ago. Look at John Bagwell inside the 35, down to the 31. Again, Tucson Kennedy with help from linebacker Kel Helms makes the stop.
They are just ripping them apart on the inside. They're doing things to Western Carolina, again, that they're not supposed to be able to do, with all conference people and good defensive people, for the most part, against the run.
That 4-4 defense is not supposed to be this easy against the run. You're absolutely right. You're supposed to have to throw against it. That's why it's designed the way it is. Sometimes you're looking at an 8-man front option, and DeBusca is going to be swarmed under. Arant is there. Geno Seegers is also there, along with Derek Harrison, number 98. The interior lineman got him out. It'll be a loss of one for Frankie DeBusca. Four carries, 26 yards now.
Again, see, we have a very curious alignment. Instead of the usual 4-4-3, they're playing variations of a 3-4 with Geno Seegers lining up as an outside end or a stand-up end and move Aran in, and they've only got two men in the middle. So apparently they're going to have to go back to their usual defensive alignment in order to be Furman today.
They fake the ball to Bagwell. And once again, it's the defense of Western Carolina that corrals the quarterback, Geno Seegers, and got Arant once again. The veterans of this defensive unit for Western Carolina right there to make the tackle on the sack.
You know, Scotty Arant and Geno Seegers are the two most dependable defensive players on the team.
You can see the standings in the Southern Conference where Furman and Western Carolina stand. 2-1 in league play for the Paladins, 1-2 for the Catamounts. And again, Furman with that number 10 national ranking in 1AA. We'll get to the top 20 in 1AA a little bit later on. Here's DeBusca, wants to throw, pressure coming, and again, it's Scott Arant, the defensive tackle, who charged in and made the stop. Another loss on the play. Three consecutive lost yardages for Furman. They just got sacked in there all three times, and you can credit not only Arant, but that secondary, because nobody was open downfield.
Yeah, that was a coverage sack that time. But again, the seniors come through. The great leadership of those two great players has come through, and maybe the Cats are ready to take their stand now.
Punting situation for the Furman Paladins. It'll be Bruce Like on to kick it away. Second in the Southern Conference in punting, averaging 40 yards per kick. Only Billy Smith of Chattanooga has a better average. The angle to the sideline. It's going to hit and bounce into the end zone. Looked like a pretty good kick when it left his foot toward the sideline, but it hit it about the 10 and took a left-hand turn right down the sideline into the end zone. We mentioned the top 20 where Furman is number 10, and there you see them, North Texas State. The Mean Green, number one, as they have been most of the season. Marshall jumping into the number two spot. They're playing Appalachian State today. That ought to be a dandy up in Huntington, West Virginia. 4:02 left to play. First quarter, Furman with a 7-0 lead over Western Carolina. Pitch out, goes to Terry. Flag is down. Terry breaks through a hole across the 30. He would have a first down, but a flag was thrown back in the linebacker area on the defensive side of the ball. Ivan Johnson and Kelly Fletcher coming in, helping to make the stop, but it's going to be holding against Western Carolina. There's the bottom 10 of the top 20. Appalachian State, number 11, Southern Conference team. And look at number 18. After a four-year absence from the top 20, the Bulldogs from the Citadel appear in the top 20.
Makes for a great game in a couple of weeks.
It sure does. The 19th of November, we'll be right here.
And I can't wait.
four teams in the Southern Conference in the top 20, Kendall. That's going to make it awfully tough to keep at least, if things can go the way they are right now, keep at least three of those teams out of the playoffs.
And you could conceivably have a scenario where the Southern Conference is playing for the national championship, 1AA. So it's a good situation for the conference.
Less than 4 minutes to play. First quarter. First down and 20 for Western Carolina. Wide receivers go either side. A look at Todd Cottrell, son of former basketball coach of the Catamounts. There's a little slip forward, and the two linebackers are there to make the stop. Kevin Kendrick, Jeff Blankenship, they corral David Jones, the fullback, on that little slip forward. That does go down as a forward pass.
You know, Pete,
forward pass.
This game is all about momentum, and it's all about what you did last play. After the defensive stand that the Cats made and then come back and they get the holding play, it could stop the momentum, but that play, again, it demonstrates this team is not going to roll over and lay down.
3:10 left to play in the quarter, and Todd Cottrell doesn't like what he sees on the defensive side. Either that or he doesn't like the play selection, and he's going to call a timeout. So Cottrell calls a timeout. He'll go to the sideline, talk to the offensive brain trust of Western Carolina. Coach Bob Waters over there on the sideline. Bob Waters, a remarkable story for this Western Carolina club. For 20 years, he has been the head football coach at Western Carolina. Definitely the dean of coaches in this league. As Lou Gehrig's disease has fought it tooth and nail for the last several years. He has lost the use of his arms. He's lost the use of his legs. He has given up his job as athletic director, but he would not give up his job as head football coach.
That's certainly a very inspirational story, one to his players and one to people who don't play for him, just who are familiar with the story. To be continuing on in the face of such adversity is really inspirational.
And after a look at Bob Waters, he travels in a wheelchair. His coaches help him with everything he needs. They help him with dinner, whatever he might need. But he's still got that mind. He's still got that football mind. And everybody in this league knows Bob Waters, and they respect his ability as a head football coach. Second down and 12 for Western Carolina. After having a first and 20 following a holding call, they'll go up the middle with the fullback, David Jones. And Jones gets to the 20 and is knocked down after a gain of two. It brings up third down and a little less than 10. Furman's defense has been rated as one of the best in the country all season long. In total defense, they are sixth in the nation, and they lead the Southern Conference 225.9 yards per game. This Furman defense gives up. Western Carolina, you can see them down in seventh position in the league. 225 a game, that's mighty stingy, Kendall.
Very stingy as compared to 375 by Western Carolina.
Cottrell back to pass out of the shotgun, looking over the middle. Nobody there. He goes to his outlet man. That's going to be the fullback, Jones, and he's not going to get the first down. He'll be about 5 yards short. So Western Carolina is forced into another punting situation, and once again, the defense has held.
Now, we're talking about good defense here. Furman has a superior defense. Cottrell that time had lunchtime to look for a receiver. Couldn't find one downfield.
Once again, Anthony Fair will kick it away. And Pat Turner is again back deep to receive for Furman. High snap, but controlled by Fair. Low line drive kick that drives Turner back inside the 25. He comes back, have a little bit of a seam, and he got across the 35 out near the 40. They'll spot him at the 39-yard line, and it'll be a first and 10 for the Paladins of Furman.
Looking on the field, we see Bobby Doherty's back, so we're glad to see he's all right.
Well, apparently with the new need for Bobby to see a lot of playing time at tailback, they don't want to take that chance of him getting hurt returning kicks. He is now the starting tailback with the injury to fullback Kenneth Goldsmith and the the removal from... Here's Billy Stockdale. Stockdale is up near midfield, stopping at the 49-yard line. What I was trying to spit out just a moment ago is the moving of Dwight Sterling from tailback to fullback to replace Kenneth Goldsmith. Doherty's going to see a lot more time in the lineup, and he's going to have to stay healthy, and that means probably not returning many kicks.
Well, if he stays healthy and can fulfill that running back slot, you've got pure dynamite in a small package for Furman.
It's a first down for the Furman Paladins. Foster in the eye. DeBust pitches it back to Doherty. Tries to turn the corner. He does. Inside the 35, inside the 30 to the 29. And Furman running right over Western Carolina and that 4-4 alignment. Craig Williamson, Scotty Aram making the stop. And there you see Bobby Doherty. 444 yards on the year rushing the football, 63.4 per ball game. Goldsmith injured, lost for the year, still second in the league in rushing behind Adrian Johnson of the Citadel. And the teams will back off the line of scrimmage while they set the football and the chains on the sidelines. Having a little equipment problem over there. Only 57 seconds left to play in the first quarter, and it's been a quarter that's been dominated by not only the Furman defense, but the Furman offense. They have been very successful running the football against the Catamounts.
Well, so far, Pete, we thought the game would be a little more competitive than it has been, but one person has really stood out in my mind, and that's Scotty Aaron. He's all over the field for the Catamounts.
He and Geno Seegers have both been involved in a lot of plays defensively. Again to the run. Doherty is hit and knocked down. He'll lose a yard. Bobby Doherty from Swannanoa dropped for a loss on the play. Arant again is in on the play. Arant's a senior from Greensboro, North Carolina. 6'3", 280 pounds.
Of quickness. He is very fast.
He has seven tackles for loss this year and three quarterback sacks. So 10 times he's gotten behind the line of scrimmage to dump a quarterback or a running back, and that doesn't include today. Here's a pass over the middle to Greg Key, and he's down to the 15. Second catch by Key today. The first one for a touchdown. This one for a Furman first down.
And again, he is wide open. Someone is missing an assignment and allowing him to run across the middle of a defense, which you never want to do. And he's wide open. The bus has all day. He's tapping feet. He's dancing. And completes the pass.
And the first quarter has come to a close from Paladin Stadium and Gene Stone Field in Greenville, South Carolina. And the Furman Paladins lead the Western Carolina Catamounts by a score of 7-0. It'll be Furman football at the 15, driving for another score when we come back right after this. Doherty dropped for a loss of about a yard back to the 17-yard line. It'll be second down and 11 yards to go as we are just underway in the second quarter. Palisade and Brazil, Furman, Western Carolina, nothing. Dwight Sterling now in the ball game at fullback. But this is the best. He wants to throw, and the ball is batted down at the line of scrimmage. I believe that was Derek Harrison who got hand up and knocked it down. Number 98, the defensive tackle.
And you know, Pete, this is very interesting, the defense they're playing. They're playing an unbalanced line in a 4-4. Now, they usually play a 4-4-3. What they've done is Craig Williamson, who's usually a linebacker, he drops back into the defensive secondary, sort of like a rover. Geno Seegers is now playing like a linebacker, therefore giving them more mobility, but it hasn't been working up until these last couple of plays.
Now, they're coming with only two down linemen. Now, they've got three, and we're going to have a whistle and a timeout by Furman. Frankie DeBust doesn't like what he saw. So both teams have now used a timeout.
Again, in this defensive scheme that the Cats are now using, it allows them to mask the different defenses they're playing. Take, for example, Aaron comes up into the line, he drops back. Or Seegers does the same thing, and the same thing with Williamson. It just gives the defense a different look, one that DeBusk is not comfortable with, one that he hasn't seen during the week in film, obviously. And it just may add a wrinkle to this game where Furman just won't be rolling the catch.
DeBusk coming back to the huddle after talking with Jimmy Satterfield on the sideline. Well, we talked about Bob Waters on the other side. This is some kind of an offensive genius in Jimmy Steinerfeld. He has led Furman for the last several years as offensive coordinator, and now in his third year as the head coach, and the offense hasn't missed a beat.
Well, of course, under Dick Sheridan here also, he was an offensive-minded coach, as was Dick Sheridan. So he's learned from good people, and he's continued the tradition of great Furman offense.
You caught a glance of the position of Todd Cottrell on the total offense leaders for Western Carolina. Furman's not flashy. They don't have anybody up in that list, but they are getting the job done. Here's Quarles with a big catch at the five. He stretched out nicely and kept his foot inbound. George Quarles leading the team with 11 catches on the year, that one included.
Well, I'll tell you what, if Frankie DeBus continues to get this kind of lunch time to pass the football, no matter what kind of defensive alignment the Cats employ, they're going to be in trouble. You cannot give a quarterback time to sit back there and pick you apart.
Second catch of the day by Quarles. Two catches, 22 yards. And Frankie DeBus, 5 of 7 for 70 yards in the first half so far. Nice job by that young quarterback from Greenville, Tennessee. Furman pitches it out. This is Doherty. Doherty scores. It's 13-0. Furman in a cakewalk so far over Western.
Just a simple pitch to the outside, away from the strong side of the defense. There was nothing the Cats could do. Bobby Doherty in for the sixth.
And one thing I was very impressed that Bobby Doherty did, he waited. He was patient until the hole opened up for him. And then he saw it, and then he took it.
Well, that's something that a lot of young backs, all you young football players out there, you can watch how he used his blocking. He didn't outrun him. He didn't run too slow. He went just right. And as a result, he got the pick.
Furman with 13 going for number 14. And we still have 14 minutes left to play in the second quarter. Wood on to attempt the extra point out of the hold of Ivan Johnson. Snap is good. Kick on the way. And the kick is good as well. With 14-13 left to play in the second quarter from Paladin Stadium, it's Furman 14, Western Carolina nothing. The Paladins on their way offensively, Kendall. And a little statistic I was looking at this morning, taking a look at what Furman has done when they have scored 21 points or more, and I'll tell you why I picked out the number 21. In the Furman locker room, there is a list of goals on a bulletin board that they look at every day during practice, what they want to accomplish in a ball game. One of those goals is to score 21 points or more each and every ball game. When Furman has done that, going all the way back to the 1985 season, when Furman has scored 21 points or more in a ballgame, they are 31-2.
And one of those losses is against guess who? Southern Carolina, Western Carolina, 31-27. So this is it looks good for Furman, especially on the offensive side of the ball. They're piling up a yardage, and they could end up with a record day, especially if Western Carolina gives Buck all day to pass the football.
Yeah, they've given him all day so far. That last drive, 8 plays, 61 yards. The touchdown on the run by Doherty.
I'm very impressed with the Furman offense today. They're a good-looking football team anyway, but when they move like that, they're excellent.
This kickoff is high, coming down to Washington at the 8. Boy, he's smothered at the 22. Who made the hit? That was number 42, Norris, I believe, who made that stop. Steve Norris, a freshman from Dalton, Georgia. And Western Carolina starts their next possession, their third of the day, from the 23-yard line.
This is a very key series for the Catamount team. If they don't get something on the board right here, they could be very well snowed under by a very crisp Furman team.
When we look at the time of possession, it's going to be absolutely staggering. Western hasn't come up with a first down yet, and they're going to lose a yard here on the pitch to the tailback. Carlton Terry driven to the ground by Jeff Blankenship, the linebacker, and the intensity level, despite a 14-0 lead, has not dropped an iota for Furman.
It looks that way. They look like they're one of just very the catch. And, of course, I can understand that. They haven't beaten the Catamounts here since 1985, so it's something that they really want to do.
They haven't beaten them since 85. They haven't beaten them in Greenville since 82. Western going for four consecutive wins here in Greenville. No other team has a winning record except for Eastern Kentucky, and they've only played Furman once. And that ball is going to be driven out of bounds along with the quarterback. Sammy Walker is the man that had him by the jersey and spun him out of bounds at the 10. Big loss on the play. And that that rushing defense is just absolutely incredible, and they're not allowing the passes to get off either. Let's take a look at how Furman's defense has done against the ground game this year. 88.9 yards a game. It's impossible to run against Furman, or it has been so far this year.
And theoretically, football speaking, if you can't run against the team, you will not be able to pass, and that's proven true.
And you saw Western Carolina in last place against the run, what Furman likes to do best. All the statistics point to a big day offensively for Furman, and we have not been disappointed so far. Cottrell on the roll, missed by Craven. He's scrambling, and he's going to be dragged down by Blankenship after a gain of about five. Still way short of a first down, and Western Carolina will have to punt for the third consecutive series, three downs and out for the Catamounts.
This really must feel like a scrimmage to Furman because we're not allowing the Cats to do anything they want to do, which is run the football primarily, so that they could pass it. They're not getting anything done on offense.
That was actually their fourth possession, so four times, three downs and out, and Anthony Bear on to kick again. Low snap, but he got it. Low line drive kick. It's going to hit once, twice, and take a run by Turner. He's going to pick it up and try to turn the corner a little bit. No such luck. He's brought down just inside the 35 by Steve Hanna, an outside linebacker, a freshman from Gatlinburg, Tennessee. Furman with the football once again. 14-0, they have the lead with 12:33 left to play. We're in the second quarter.
I'm going to go out on a limb here, Pete. If Furman scores this time, that's pretty much going to do it for this game.
I tell you what, I have seen too many of these Furman-Western Carolina games to believe that. Timeout called for by the defense of Western Carolina. Looks like an injury to one of their players. That's number 49, Cal Helms, the linebacker. He was holding his back as he was headed off the field. I don't know if he's hurt or... Well, he's talking to one of his coaches over on the sideline. Doesn't appear like he's going to take himself out of the ball game. So Western Carolina has taken another timeout, their second of this half. Let's take a look at the stats on total offense. Furman right there among the Southern Conference leaders, only 6 yards or so behind the thundering herd of Marshall. And as far as team offense is concerned, Furman ranks 15th in the nation in total offense.
So again, you've got the staggering statistical advantage on Furman's side.
Here comes Furman to the line of scrimmage. Well, the first and 10, and 12:33 left to play in the second quarter. Western Carolina with only one timeout remaining in the half. They've taken two already. Sterling and Bagwell, the runners behind the bus. This is Sterling. Sterling finds a hole, runs right through it. He coughed up the football, though. It's going to be recovered by Western Carolina. Cal Helms made the stick that popped the ball loose.
And I'm telling you, he hit him a ton, and the ball just squirted loose.
Well, in turnovers this year, that's been one of Furman's only problem areas. And you can see right there, Furman, plus two in the turnover column, meaning per ball game, they give the ball away two more times than they take it away, and that's a problem.
And winning teams very seldom do that.
Western Carolina with their first break of the ball game in Furman territory for the first time. They give it off to Carlton Terry inside the 45, down to the 42 for a gain of three. And Kelly Fletcher makes the stop for Furman. Let's take a look at that defense of the Furman Paladins, which we have not done yet. Kelly Fletcher, Chris Roper, Craven, Burr, Pitts, that front line, they've done an outstanding job this year.
And they pursue very well to the football. They are a very good, very physical defensive team, and still surprising quickness.
The linebackers we've all heard about, Blankenship and Kendrick, they've just been fantastic. Back to pass. Cottrell. Downfield he goes, and nobody's there. Nobody is there at all. His intended receiver was Andy Schultz, but he got hung up on the line of scrimmage. The closest man to the ball was Julius Dixon, the cornerback, the senior from Stevens County High School in Toccoa, Georgia.
Again, he had plenty of time, but the coverage is there. Eventually, with that kind of scenario, when you got plenty of time and the coverage is there, they're going to lead to a lot of coverage sacks, and Cottrell's going to have a longer day than he's already had.
Todd Cottrell, only 2 of 4 for 13 yards so far. Third down and 7 for West. Western Carolina from the shotgun. He's back, he fires, and he overfires his man. It was intended for Otis Washington on a little out pattern. Pat Turner with the coverage for Furman, and it brings up another fourth down. So despite being handed the ball in Furman territory, Western Carolina is not able to come away with anything on the ground or through the air.
And you've got to be able to take advantage of Furman when they give you opportunities to score. They're not going to get many of them on their own. It doesn't look like at this point in the football game.
Back deep to receive is Turner. Bear with another kick. It's away. Oh, what a high kick. It'll probably get into the end zone, but a beautiful high kick by Anthony Bear. It landed on the one and jumped into the end zone. Furman will have it first and 10 from the 20-yard line. Good hustle down the field by Ricky Garden, a sophomore from Morganton, North Carolina, to try and keep the ball in the field of play.
So far, with this game is really starting to take shape. It looks like it's going to be a Furman day offensively and defensively. But last time that Furman had the football, a new defensive alignment kind of gave the Paladins trouble. So we'll have to watch and see how it transpires over a whole series of downs.
Now we see another kind of alignment for Western Carolina. They've got five men, now six men creeping up on the line. Quick pass out, incomplete. Intended for Brad Stevens, but it was too tall for him. Ricky Garden, number 17, in on the pass protection for the Catamounts.
And the reason why that pass was incomplete, Pete, was because for the first time today, they got in Frankie DeBus's face. It's not all about sacks, it's about pressure. And he got pressured very well that time.
Stevens comes to the near side as the wide receiver. Quarles to the left side. For the first time today, we see Furman in the broken bone. Back to pass. DeBus throws behind his intended receiver, the tight end, Keith Willing, and it's incomplete. It'll be third down and 10 for Furman.
Again, looking over the defensive statistics that were coming into this game, it looked like Western Carolina had a decent defensive line, one that could put pressure on the quarterback, one who could stop the run to a point. Now they're really starting to assert themselves, and for the second play in a row, again, the key to this game is getting into Buck's face.
John Clardy, wide receiver, a sophomore from Greenville, Tennessee, comes to the near side as the wideout. He and Frankie DeBus teamed together at Greenville, Tennessee High School, and now Furman is going to call another timeout. Frankie DeBus coming to the sideline, and there you can see how successful Furman has been putting points on the board. These figures, including today, Furman with 52 points in the first quarter, 48 in the second, 34, and then 49, so 183 total points per season, and 24 points per game this year. That's not a bad figure, 24 points a game. It's not exactly among the national leaders, but it'll get you a few wins.
With a defense like Furman, 24 points a game will lead to a lot of wins, a lot of wins. They have a great defense for 24 points a game.
And so far, it's led to five this season. Nothing in favor of the Furman Paladins. Furman's having some trouble with their alignment. They're trying to flip-flop people. Vinton Bell, Brad Stevens, having to flip sides. They had to flip the tight end from one side to the other. And time is running out on them. They do get the snap off. It's a little trap play on the change. And they give it off to Stockdale up the middle. And he's across the 25 out to the 26. But not nearly enough for a first down. It'll be a fourth down for the Paladins. And coming back on to punt will be Bruce White.
They're trying to adjust to the new schemes and the new formations that the Cats are coming up with. This game has really tightened up. Even though Furman scored the last time down, I'd say about half of that drive, Furman really had to struggle for the yards they got. So it should be interesting on off.
Back deep to receive, Don Thomas. Standing inside the 40. Line drive kick. Thomas should have fun with this one, but Furman's covering it very well. Great job. Sherrod Weber was the first one there. Number 28, Sherrod Weber, the first man down for Furman defensively. And usually a low line drive kick like that, Kendall, will give the running back time to get upfield and find his hole, but not that time.
Well, I was afraid that he may have outkicked his coverage, but the wind kind of held it up, got Furman in position, and they hammered the young man.
10 29 left to play in the first half, and Furman leading 14 to nothing. Big game, as we told you earlier today. Appalachian State taking on Marshall in Huntington, West Virginia. And for those of you watching this ball game in the PM hours on the replay, this, you may know a final, but right now in the daytime hours when we're taping this game, it is 14-7 Appalachian over Marshall, and the crowd just responded to that score.
Yeah, that's what we want to happen. We want to have a chance to win the conference championship outright.
A win by Furman today over Western Carolina, a win by Appalachian State, and you've got a first-place tie in the Southern Conference between Marshall, Appalachian State, and Furman, all with one loss.
In the situation we talked about, where they have to take three teams from the Southern Conference, pretty much.
And, you know, it all depends on what the Citadel does as well. The Citadel with only one loss in league play. On second down and nine, David Jones across the 35 to the 36. Still not much success running the football for Western Carolina. And I'm continually amazed at why they keep trying to run the football at Furman. Nobody has had success all season running the football against the Paladins. They are a passing team, but they're just trying as hard as they can to establish some semblance of the ground game to make their passing game more effective. From the shotgun, linebackers are coming. From the outside, Kelly Fletcher chasing the quarterback, Cottrell. The throw is incomplete, and Kelly Fletcher almost had sack number 10.
You know, that was an all-out sprint to the quarterback that time. The ball was snapped. Kelly Fletcher just ran down. Cottrell was back. He had to give it away. He had a receiver open for a minute over the middle of the field, but he couldn't turn and throw the football. Therefore, it was an incomplete pass. Furman gets the ball back.
With 9:09 to play, Anthony Bear is kicking again.
That young man's leg's going to get tired, isn't it?
Fifth-rated kicker in the Southern Conference, and Furman's lining everybody up on the line. 10 men will rush.
They'll probably get this one because they've come close with only a few. They got it.
Here they come, and they missed it. And they didn't knock Bear down. That's unbelievable. At the 20, Pat Turner knocked down. Nice hit that time by number 42, Steve Hanna. Second time he's been out there on special teams.
And Bear got off a great kick that time, especially with under the pressure that he was under.
The sixth punt of the day, and we're in the first half. 8:58 left to play. First half, 14-0, Furman on top of Western Carolina.
Let's see if the defensive trend continues here, Pete. Let's see if Western Carolina can continue to stop Furman and get into Buck's face.
Doherty has been the tailback for much of the day, leading ground gainer so far with 44 yards. But this is Sterling, and Sterling, with only his second carry of the day, gets about one.
Again, James Morris from Canton, Georgia, on that side of the field. He just caved in that side of the line, which is a very strong, physically speaking, offensive line, and they stopped him for only a one-yard gain. The game has taken on a whole new hue.
Second and nine. The gains on first down are getting smaller and smaller for Furman. Here's Doherty, tripped up in the backfield. Nobody hit him, but he tripped and fell. Not going to get any yardage. No gain on the play. Third down and nine for Furman. It's Derek Harrison was the man that covered it.
When I looked at the size and the weight of these young men on the Western Carolina side of the football, I was very impressed with their size. And I thought that they may be able to offset some of that strength of Furman's. And at this point, at least for the last two or three series, they have done exactly that.
Number 32, John Bagwell, has come into the ball game. He'll line up as a flanker. Look for a pass to him. The throw is out. The throw is complete. But to Brad Stevens, first down, still on his feet to midfield. Errol Wagner, the cornerback, made the stop. You know, it looked like the pass was going to Bagwell out of the backfield. But at the last moment, DeBusk looked up and saw Stevens downfield splitting that defense, and he found him wide open, and he picked up about five more yards. And you can look at the passing offense of Furman, unimpressive on the season, only 96 yards per ball game, but they've already got more than that today.
Well, as we said at the top, if you can't pass on the catch, you can't pass.
Back to pass again as DeBusk is scrambling away from trouble. He throws to a wide open John Bagwell, who makes the catch falling down.
Frankie DeBusk was very impressive on that play. Getting pressure, rolling out for him, back across.
clutch just to get the pass off. And tell me, is John Bagwell glad to be back from that early season knee injury?
With a catch like that, and open as he was, I would be glad to be back.
7:10 left to play as the clock continues to run in the first half. But Furman pushing it down the field through the air, which is so remarkable. DeBusk is just getting more accurate as the season goes on. Here is Sterling, stood up at the line of scrimmage and pushed back. He may have gotten a yard. James Morris making the stop for Western Carolina from his defensive end position. It'll bring up a second down and 9 as they do give him 1 yard on the carry.
These teams have really gotten out of character. Western Carolina's trying to run and Furman is passing.
How about that?
What will they think of next?
Furman with 12 first downs, 6 passing, 6 rushing. Western hasn't got a first down yet. There's Doherty inside the 15 to the 10-yard line. That's going to be close to a first down, but it won't be quite enough. He'll need about another yard and a half as they'll spot him just on the outside of the 10. So give him to the 11, and it'll be third down. Bobby Doherty, another impressive run for the Furman Paladins, and let's check his figures on today. 51 yards on 9 carries.
51 yards on 9 carries is a Bobby Doherty type day today. A little over 5 yards per carry.
And he's going to get more carries per game for the rest of the season. Now that Sterling's playing fullback, and this is Sterling. Sterling keeps his footing, gets the first down near the 5. First down and goal for Furman. And if they want to run, they run. And if they want to pass, they've been passing today.
It looks like Western Carolina plays defense between the 20s. Once they get within the 20-yard line, Furman, that is, there is nothing Western Carolina can do. The Furman will to score seems to be very, very strong today. They can sense a big day.
An extra linebacker comes in the ball game for Western Carolina. Carlton Phillips is in there. Here's Doherty to the outside. He's going to be tripped up and knocked down. Number 81, James Morris.
That was a great play. He got blocked, fell down, and still had enough presence of mind to reach out and trip him up before he could get back to the line of scrimmage.
You know, I think this is where Furman is going to miss Kenneth Goldsmith more than anything. Usually, Goldsmith is the lead blocker on those sweeps, and he clears the lane and allows them to turn the corner. And to be, in all honesty, not to downgrade Dwight Sterling, he's just not the blocker of a Kenneth Goldsmith. He doesn't have the practice at it. Pass over the middle. Touchdown. Keith Swilling, the tight end on the reception. And Frankie DeBusk is threading needles today, folks, but he's also had some men wide open like on that play.
He is very, very impressive today, Steve. He rolled out again, rolled out to the weak side, saw the man in the clear, tossing the ball beautifully. He didn't get touched, no coverage, touchdown.
77 yards on the drive for the Furman Paladins as Mike Wood is on to attempt another extra point. It's 20 to nothing. Make it 21. And what was that statistic we went to earlier in the ball game? Since the 1985 season, when Furman has scored 21 points or more, they are 31-2.
They scored 21 today, so that gives you an idea of where this game is.
And, you know, Furman's defense has not given up a touchdown since, well, you've got to go back to last season against Appalachian State, October 17th. That's the last time the defense has given up a touchdown. Remember, a few weeks ago, they gave up 2 scores to VMI, but both of those were given up by the offense. There's a look at number 35, Kenneth Goldsmith, the Furman fullback. A senior, 8 on the career rushing list with the Paladins, and that's the culprit.
Yeah, that's the crusher. But they don't seem to be missing a beat today, at least not at this particular point. Against the defense that was supposed to stop the run, they haven't even missed him. And let's be honest, Goldsmith is a running back, but he's really a guard in the guise of a running back because he blocks that well.
That's a very, very good observation. He is, without a doubt, the best blocker in the Southern Conference. An offensive lineman at fullback. That's the way to look at it. Connolly kicks off. And Washington waits on it at the 10. Catches it on the run. He is up to the 20 and the 25, and that's it. Flags go down at the 25. We'll have to wait and see on that one as Washington was crushed at the 25. Mike Bobrovsky, one of the men, number 53, down there to make the stop. But again, we did have flags down on the play, and we're waiting for the indication. It's clipping against the Catamount. So from the 25, Furman will probably take this one, push them back a little bit. Then again, Western Carolina will start in bad field position.
And they can ill afford bad field position, especially when they haven't been moving the ball at all. So if they don't get a first down out of this ball at the 12 now, if they don't get a first down out of this, Furman again will have a chance to go in before the half and conceivably be up 28-0.
And Western Carolina has yet to get a first down this afternoon.
That is a staggering statistic in this age of offensive football and with a strong-arm quarterback like Cocker.
The Catamounts have simply had three downs and outs. This is their seventh possession of the day. Low snap into the shotgun formation. A new quarterback in the ball game. This is Mark Smith, number 14. And his pass is complete. Raymond Taylor on the catch. He's the tight end out to the 20-yard line. Jeff Blankenship making the stop, and there's a look at the tackle leaders in the Southern Conference. Blankenship number one. Kevin Kendrick is second. Also a couple of Western Carolina players in the top 10. Smith back again, throws, his pass is deflected, and again, it is the linebacker Jeff Blankenship and Kevin Kendrick who were back there making the deflection. Kendrick was the man that got his hand on the ball and knocked it away.
He took a nice, even, deep drop, got in the passing lane, tipped that football, and of course, it stopped the completion by Smith.
Smith, one of two, but I tell you what, that pass was on the mark had Kevin not gotten up and knocked it away.
Maybe a new quarterback is just the fire that the Cats need to get back into this football game before halftime.
Schultz comes to the near side. Washington wide right. There's a look at Smith, a sophomore from York, South Carolina. He gives it off to the second man through, Carlton Terry, up to the 25. He's going to have a first down, the first of the day for the Catamounts, and Sherrod Weber from Strong Safety makes the stop. We're inside of 4 minutes remaining in the first half. Furman 21, Western Carolina nothing. Again from the shotgun. Passes out. Pass, I think, is incomplete. I thought he dropped it and then picked it up again, but they're going to call it complete at the 30. Flags, however, have gone down. Back at the 20-yard line. Looks like it's going to be a holding call against Western Carolina. That will negate the catch. They're talking with Jeff Blankenship, the Furman captain, out on the field.
The good old drive stopper, a holding penalty. I think it seems to stop more penalty or stop more drives than any other penalty.
Would have been a decent game on first down for the Catamounts. This will wipe it out, holding Western Carolina. They're going to march it off. It'll be first down and 20 now. 3 minutes and 40 seconds left to play. Second quarter. The second penalty of the day by Western Carolina. Another pass. They're going long this time. Julius Dixon was downfield, ready to make the interception on the pass intended for Schultz.
Schultz turned into a defensive back on that one. He shoved Julius Dixon so he wouldn't have an opportunity to intercept the ball. And that's what you have to do if you're a receiver. You see, you're not going to catch the ball. Don't let the defensive man catch the football. Do something, even if you have to get a penalty, to stop the interception.
And I'm not sure that catch would have been good even had the players caught the ball, because both of them had been out of bounds at one point heading down the sideline. 21-0, Furman on top. Mark Smith, the backup quarterback, the sophomore in the ball game for Todd Cottrell. He'll swing one out to Jones, his fullback, and Jones is going to be dragged down by Blankenship at the 20, a gain of about four, and that's going to be it. Again, you can credit the secondary of Furman. They're shutting down the deep receiver. That last pass, the one that was thrown to Schultz deep, was simply in desperation. He was well covered by Julius Dixon. Now it's a third down and 15 for the Catamounts. Pressure coming. Pass again to Jones, the fullback, and he's going to get some yardage, about 7 yards, but nothing near the first down. It's going to be fourth down and 8 for Western Carolina, and another punting situation with 2.5 minutes left to play in the half and an injured player on the field for Furman. That is Chris Roper, the defensive end, the junior from West Columbia. He's going to get up on his own power. Jeff Blankenship is over there talking with him, acting as a trainer, trying to see if he can stay in the ballgame. I don't think there's any chance of that.
Well, Chris is just probably asking that someone please pick that phone up, because those bells are ringing after that when he got dinged a little bit. And he should be all right. He looks like he's going to be all right. Just a little woozy.
Trainer Bruce gets out there. They're going to come back to the sideline with him.
Someone's after the phone for him.
Steve Norris has already made one good play defensively today on special teams. He'll be in replacing Roper. Pat Turner back deep to receive the punt, and this time Furman looks like they're setting up the return. Another good kick by Anthony Baer, driving Turner back inside the 25. Comes back up the middle and is knocked down, and a flag is going to be thrown on Kevin Kendrick, and you can see the disgust on his face. An illegal block from behind against Furman's Kevin Kendrick, and that'll march Furman back down near about the 20, maybe 15-yard line. That's a lady catamount.
Is that what you would call a... Kitty Mount?
Might be.
Okay.
The Catamount is talking to fans on the other side of the fence. 2:07 left to play as Furman will have the football, but they'll have it at about the 15-yard line.
Back to their 14 for Kitty. First and 10.
21-0. Furman has had it their way all day. Touchdown pass to Greg Key, the tight end. Another touchdown pass to Keith Swilling, and a touchdown run of 12 yards by Bobby Doherty. Here is John Bagwell, and Bagwell will pick up 5 near the 20. Making the tackle is David Johnson, the linebacker. Let's check the yardage of John Bagwell rushing the football today. He only needed 31 yards to move into 8th place on the all-time rushing list for the Paladins. With that 5-yard pickup, he did it. Unofficially, we have him with 33 yards, so he is now the number 8 rusher on the all-time rushing list for Furman, and that is Dwight Sterling across the 30 for a first down. Tackle made by Craig Williamson and by Ricky Garten, the right side cornerback.
At one point, we were thinking that this new defensive alignment by the catch would be able to slow down this Paladin Express, but as of yet, nothing has slowed the Paladin Express down except one turnover.
Furman's coaching staff has shown a great ability to adjust in this ball game today. 1:11 left to play. DeBusk back to pass. Pressure coming. Good block by Bagwell, and DeBusk is free. Throwing downfield. He's got his man. This is Quarles, and Quarles still on his feet. Gets inside the 25. They're going to mark him at, I beg your pardon, the 35. They'll mark him at the 36. And it's going to be a first down for Furman. And the scrambling of Furman's quarterback, Frankie DeBusk, has allowed him to get some passes off downfield. This one, however, will be called back an ineligible receiver downfield for the Furman Palace.
And that was brought on by all the scrambling. He looked like he was going to run there for a minute. He looked like he was going to pass, and then he kept changing his mind. When he finally got the pass away, apparently a lineman had crossed the line of scrimmage, and therefore the penalty.
From our vantage point, you would say it's kind of hard to blame a lineman like that. You're having to guess what the quarterback's going to say, but I guarantee you when they watch this on the films, the coaches will be all over those players for not holding their ground.
Oh, yeah, on a pass play, you have to expect that the quarterback is going to get rid of the football and not run downfield.
Less than a minute to play in the second quarter. First down and 15 for the Furman Paladins. Sterling and Bagwell, the backs behind DeBusk. And this is Bagwell. Cuts to the outside. Power running by Bagwell. It's going to take three people to run him out of bounds. And finally, Tucson Kennedy, number one, the safety man, is the man that leads the charge in getting John out of bounds. He'll get up to the 31-yard line for a gain of four, 36 yards on the day on four carries for the senior from Somerville, South Carolina.
That time Bagwell just made his mind up, I'm not going down in or out of bounds, and they had to ride him out on a saddle.
Furman may have to get one playoff. There's now 19 seconds left on the clock in the first half, and Furman appears to be quite content to go into the locker room with a 21-0 lead over the Catamounts of Western Carolina. Tripping and falling forward is Dwight Sterling, and that's going to do it. And the Furman defense has now gone 26 consecutive quarters without giving up a touchdown here at Paladin Stadium in Greenville. And we go to the locker room. At the half, Furman 21, Western Carolina nothing. Paladin Furman will receive to start the second half, but Kendall Lewis, let's take a look at some of the first half statistics, and they were impressive statistics for the Furman Paladins. Total offense, Furman 281 yards, 52 for Western Carolina.
It doesn't get any better on offense than it did for Furman in the first half, and it doesn't get any worse, conversely, than it got for Western Carolina.
For the Paladins, 29 carries, 144 yards on the ground, but 137 yards through the air. That was the shocking statistic.
These teams have been switching roles, it seems like, throughout the first half. If the trends continue as they have been going, Furman will probably set some type of record on the passing end of the continuum, whereas Western Carolina will get just massacred in the second half. And look for a very competitive game, although Furman is just overpowering right now.
Taking a look at Western Carolina's first half statistics, they gained only 20 yards on 13 carries on the ground, 32 yards through the air, and that was the problem they had. They also lost 13 yards rushing to the Furman's on-digging defense. So Furman's defense came at Western Carolina, got them behind the line a lot, and that's why their statistics look so bad. But total offense, 52 yards. That's just a great job by the Furman defense. Only one turnover in the ballgame. That was by Furman. And basically, it's been a cleanly played game in terms of penalties. Only five during the course of the first half.
A person who's really standing out to me is the quarterback you see on the screen, Frankie DeBusk. He's having an excellent day running and throwing the football and directing Furman's offense.
Well, you can look at the first down situation and tell Furman's moved the football. 13 first downs for the Paladins, only one for Western Carolina. This is Julius Dixon for Furman, returning the kick out beyond the 25 to the 26-yard line, and that's where the Paladins will start. First and 10. Let's quickly run down how everything is going for the Furman Paladins during the course of this second half. As we start, Quarles, Swilling, and Stevens will be your receivers. Frankie DeBusk, Sterling, and Doherty in the backfield. Patterson, Adams, Dugan, Bailey, and Cowan will go across that front line. Butch Estes, the basketball coach at Furman, has joined us. We're going to pull him in here and let him put on a headset and talk to him about Furman basketball for a few moments as we see DeBusk give it off up the middle to the first man, Sterling, and there's not much there. Coach Estes, I know you're excited. Another college basketball season just around the corner.
Pete, we really are, and if we can play half as good as these Paladins are playing in football, we'll be okay.
It's been an impressive sight so far against a team that's kind of played you tough in basketball as well, the Western Carolina Catamounts. Let's talk a little bit about this basketball team. I've seen several practices, the Midnight Madness practice session. You had a scrimmage today. How did that go?
It went excellent, and you want to wait unless this play's over?
They can watch it.
Okay. Listen, I'll do commentary. You want me to? He's dropping back the pass right there.
He's got his man, too. That's Bagwell. He shakes one tackle and gets down to the 35, shy of a first down by a couple. It'll be third down and two. Let's talk about that scrimmage.
It was really good, Pete. I was very pleased. We're in great shape. Best shape we've ever been in as a team. team, probably the most difficult thing that we've got facing us is some decisions as who's going to play, you know, when, who's going to start, who's going to come off the bench.
It's a nice problem to have.
Well, it really is. We've got a lot of depth and a lot of good young players, and everybody's just working so hard. The attitude and the work ethic of this basketball team is the best we've ever had.
The injured player is James Morris, the defensive end. He's a junior from Canton, Georgia, and you can see the training staff of Western Carolina taking care of him. A lot of people have talked about your basketball program and the problems you might have with the loss of John Castile, the loss of one of your top outside shooters in Sean Reed, and then the muscle man inside in Gary Churchill, who just did anything and everything you asked of him. But you've got some good kids coming back. I know David Brown heads the list.
Well, we really do. We're going to certainly miss those three seniors. They did a lot for contributing to our rebuilding process. And, you know, a lot of times, like a lot of things in life, you don't appreciate them until you don't have them. And I think these young guys, I'm going to miss them a lot. And yet I'm enthused about the challenge we have this year. Our schedule is very difficult, but we do have good players as David Brown and Joey Brooks and Tom Chase heading that list. And, you know, Chase has made great improvements. Brooks is as solid as can be inside. He's a strong inside player who can score. And David Brown is just an exciting, dynamite, quick, good shooting guard.
Okay. Now, last year we had a couple of ball games on Telecable of Greenville. The last two games of the season with Western Carolina and with Lander. This year, 10 home games we're going to have on the tube for tape delay. And I think a lot of people are excited about that.
Well, I hope that everybody, that we can do a good job of informing everybody what a good job all you people, you and Jim, and all you people down at Telecable are doing. And we're excited that Furman University for your participation and cooperation. And we think this is the beginning of taking Greenville, taking Furman basketball to all of Greenville.
And I tell you what, I don't think we could start with a better game. December 1st, Furman and Clemson from Memorial Auditorium.
Well, I imagine seats are going to be hard to find in the auditorium, and there'll be a lot of people who want to see that game on delay afterwards. But we would like to encourage everybody who might be listening to think about season basketball tickets, because our home schedule is really improving. We got Clemson at home this year, LSU and Michigan State coming to Greenville next year, and of course with the possibilities now of the new Coliseum on campus, people who have season tickets now will be first priority when we build that new Coliseum, and I think tickets will be much harder to get when we do that.
Frankie DeBusk with the first down carry off the left side on the option. Will depend on the spot, but it will be a first down and 10. Butch Estes, best of luck for the basketball
program. Thank you,
Pete.
Appreciate
everything. Thanks for
stopping by.
First and 10 for the Furman Paladins as they'll move the chains on the far side of the field, and we are indeed looking forward to Furman University basketball this season. And again, it all starts off against the Clemson Tigers from Memorial Auditorium in Greenville. It'll be a packed house. I don't think there's any doubt about it.
I think I'm going to try to hang out with you so I can watch that one.
Oh, I think you should. Here goes Dwight Sterling across the 40. He's going to pick up a couple of yards before he's brought down, and believe me, those 2 yards he picked up were picked up by offensive line search because Western Carolina closed down the gaps in a hurry.
Again, starting the second half, Western Carolina is doing what they did at the end to middle part of the first half. They're playing tough defense, multiple formations on defense. But again, it's only a matter of time before Furman adjusts and runs the ball right down their throat, so to speak.
And Furman is doing a lot of changing in there, getting offensive players in and out of the ball game. Dwight Sterling limping off the field a little bit now. DeBusk will pass. He fires. It's incomplete. I think he wanted to go to either Greg Key or Quarles a little bit further downfield. Both of them had a shot at the ball, but if he was going for Quarles, he led him a little bit too much.
And I'll tell you, that's one of the first poor decisions DeBusk has made all day long. He had Kenneth Goldsmith, John Bagwell open out here in the flat. Nobody around him. And he chose to go into the congested side of the football field.
I'll tell you what, things are looking good for Furman up in Huntington, West Virginia. 28-7, Appalachian State dogging the thundering herd of Marshall right now. Back to pass is DeBusk. Pressure coming, and he can't slip away. He tried to duck under the pressure of Geno Seegers, but Seegers got him along with Derek Harrison, the tackle. Number 98 and 99 combining on the stop and dropping Furman for a big loss.
Another coverage sack. Although Derek Harrison was right in DeBusk's face from the very beginning of that play, he ducked under his arms, but Geno Seegers, as you said, was just too much, and they rolled him under.
And that was absolutely essential for the Western Carolina defense. They had to stop Furman on this first series of the second half. Bruce Weick on to kick. And now Western Carolina drops back, and they'll set up the return. Kick is away. Thomas. Inside the 35, wrapped up and dropped. What a job getting downfield. Mike Tiernan, the reserve linebacker, the senior, making the stop for Furman, and he just flew downfield.
He showed great speed going downfield that time. I didn't think the young man had that kind of speed.
Wind kicking up a little bit as we started the second half. From Paladin Stadium in Greenville, Pete Butler along with Kendall Lewis. Paladin defense on for the first time against Western Carolina, and quarterback Mark Smith, the sophomore Todd Cottrell, not getting the call here in the second half. Smith is back to throw. He fires, is caught, and then dropped. Otis Washington had the ball at midfield and couldn't hold on, and it was almost intercepted by one of the Furman linebackers on its way to him in flight. Here's a look at the scoring defense in the Southern Conference, and look at Furman's numbers, giving up only 9.8 points per ball game. And ladies and gentlemen, that is impressive. Second in the country in scoring defense, the Furman Paladins. Second and 10. Had a hand in his face, and Washington makes an outstanding catch at midfield, and he runs down to the 45 before he's down. Big play for Western Carolina. Credit Smith. He stood in the pocket with pressure in his face, and he got a pass off. Super catch, an athletic catch by Washington.
That was a great one-handed grab of the football. As you said, Smith stood in the pocket, knowing what kind of punishment he was going to take. Stood in there. Now Western Carolina's on the move.
Smith has done a good job throwing the football since he came in midway in the second quarter. 21-0. Furman on top of Western Carolina in the third quarter. Backs in the I formation. Wide receivers go to either side, and now they'll break out into a passing formation, and we have flag thrown. Delay of game against Western Carolina.
It seems, Pete, that every time the Cats try to get something going, there's always something to inhibit that drive or to inhibit that particular thing that they've got going, and they have to stop these petty mistakes so that they can get back in this football game and be competitive with Furman.
Third penalty of the day by Western Carolina. Three penalties, 25 yards for the Catamount today. Furman with a four down lineman. They'll be coming after Smith. Good protection. Throw over the middle is incomplete. He threw behind his intended receiver, Raymond Taylor, the tight end.
Young Mark Smith that time, he just rushed himself. He did not have to be in a big hurry. He had receivers open. He just didn't take his time, didn't concentrate on what he was doing, and as a consequence, he overthrew the receiver and very nearly got the ball intercepted.
Second down and 15 for the Catamounts. Linebackers are coming. The blitz is on. Pressure on the quarterback, and the pass is incomplete, and they didn't get the sack, but they did what they wanted to do. They hurried the quarterback.
That was a great play on both sides of the ball. The all-out blitz by Furman, Smith getting the ball away, and Otis Smith almost coming up with the football there on that play. So everybody did what they had to do except complete the pass.
Let's take a look at today's schedule in the Southern Conference. Wofford is at VMI. Wofford now in Division II. Appalachian State Marshall, we've told you about that one. UTC, Western Kentucky, a nine-league game. And East Tennessee at the Citadel, ranked number 18 in the country this week. Third down and 15. Smith, quick pass out, incomplete. It was intended for John Reed, the tight end, one of the top receivers in the Southern Conference. Did not get the call today in the starting lineup, but he's in there now when they need him the most, and he couldn't come up with that pass. It's fourth down, and Furman holds on after giving up the big pass.
For a passing team, their passing game just isn't clicking. They look a little rusty on the passing end, and they're going to have to get going what they do best. It's just that simple.
They average almost 200 yards a game through the air, and they haven't come close today. Pressure coming again on the kick. It is away. It'll be taken by Turner near the 20. Across the 20 to the 24, and that's where he's brought down, and Furman will have it first and 10 with 10:29 left to play. We're in the third quarter. Well, Furman was held on their first series of downs. Now they'll come back with Frankie DeBusk. They'll do a little bit more adjustment over on the sideline. I'd like to see Furman go a little bit more back to their ground game. I think that's what got them here, and I think that's what they're going to have to go to. The passing game is doing wonderful, but go ahead and use the pass just to keep Western Carolina honest, not as a means of consistently getting the football down the field. and they go to the second man in the eye, and that's Doherty, and so much for my brilliance as a coach. Doherty has dropped behind the line of scrimmage on the delay.
Well, see, there are two schools of thought on Furman continuing to run the football. One is they might pass the ball more now because of a lot of these running backs are going to be leaving next year. At least two of them are going to be leaving next year. And then you're looking at a situation where Western Carolina has really stiffened up against the run. So the pass just may be the way to go at this particular time in the football game.
A one-yard loss for Bobby Doherty. 11 carries, 48 yards. DeBusk slips away from one would-be tackler and throws the ball away. That was a smart play. The only man in the area was the tight end, Keith Swilling, but he was covered by Toussaint Kennedy, and the ball went out of bounds, incomplete, and it'll be third down for Furman and 11.
His name hasn't been called that much today. Toussaint Kennedy, who was the leading tackler for Western Carolina, they haven't gotten to him yet today as far as him making tackles.
Third down and 11 for the Paladins. And they'll throw again. Dump it over the middle to Quarles, who makes a nice move, and he's going to have the first down. George Quarles with his third catch of the day. Good for a Furman first down.
DeBusk stood very tall in the pocket that time. Stood there in the face of the rush, completed the pass going across, and he picked up the first down.
And that was a nice, subtle move by the receiver, George Quarles. Not a quick move, but he just made a subtle move to the outside and got the angle on the defenders and picked up the first down. It keeps the drive alive. First and 10 for Furman from the 35. Here's Doherty. He gets a couple, and that's all.
Tackle by Fred Robbs.
Fred Robbs, the defensive tackle, making the stop. He's a sophomore from Shelby, North Carolina, number 90. It'll bring up second down and 8. Jeff Blankenship on the sideline getting a breather, the leader of the Furman defense, which is without a doubt among the best in Division I-AA. Frankie DeBusk throwing downfield. Nice timing pattern as he catches his man. Again, it's Quarles down the sideline, and he hit him right in the chest. Terrell Wagner, the cornerback, on the stop.
I'll tell you what, if Terrell Wagner doesn't make that tackle, we've got a 28-0 football game because number 7, that man, he's really a good ball player once he gets into the open field with the football.
That was nothing but a touch pass. DeBusk lobbed it down there and just waited for the receiver to run under it, and a beautiful job it was. Up the middle. Here goes Billy Stockdale, the fullback. Hard man to bring down, and he's going to pick up about 5 on first down, bringing up second down and 5. Well, Furman has scored 21 points today, and they've been doing that all season long. Marshall leading the league in scoring offense with 33 a game. Furman down there in fourth position, 24 a game. Western Carolina with 19 a game. They've yet to score today against the Furman defense that has yet to give up a touchdown at home this year. And in the last 26 quarters, a fumble by Doherty, but he falls on it. He'll lose a few.
Western Carolina is a very contradictory team in terms of statistics and in terms of what they've done, who they've played well against. Here they are scoring 19 points a game, but they're giving up 300 and almost 400 yards a game. So you look at a team that's good on some days and bad on other days, and defense is giving up 27.1 points a game. So
that's a lot to ask your offense to do.
Yes, it is.
7-11. Left to play in the third quarter. Option, DeBusk fakes it. He'll be close to the first down. The ball is loose on the ground, but the officials say that the ground forced that ball to be popped loose, and so they'll spot it, and we may have a measurement. After taking a look at the football, I think we are going to have an officials measurement for the first down.
With the purchase of
21-0 to score. They'll stretch out the sticks. It will not be a first down. A little bit short. It's going to be fourth down.
Fourth and one.
Well, you can tell by the decision of head coach Jimmy Satterfield that he does not feel this game is in the pocket yet. He'll go for it on fourth down. And this is not an effort to run up the score. He's just looking for a little bit of security here in the third quarter. It's 21-0. Furman has dominated. But Western Carolina has shown us over the years they can turn things around in a hurry. Pitch out, Bagwell. Usually he's consistent. He is this time. He gets the first down, picking up about 3 yards down to the 30.
If Western Carolina can turn this game around, we have been witnessing one of the greatest football games that we're going to see in a long time, because Furman is really hitting on all cylinders. This is an interesting drive. They started deep in their own territory. Now they're at the 30-yard line of the catch. So it's going to be very interesting to see how far down they can go and see if they can take it in for a touchdown. It's not been a pretty drive, but it's been effective nonetheless.
You know, this is very, very much unlike most of the games that have been played recently in this series between Furman and Western Carolina. We'll take a look at how this series has gone the last few years after this play. Here comes the reverse. We can smell it. This is Stevens. He cuts inside the 25 down to the 23-yard line. Western Carolina did a good job of recovering because they had everything moving to the defensive right, and they had to cut back to the other side. And it'll still be a second down and three. Brad Stevens on the carry for Furman.
Scotty Aran saw it was a reverse immediately, but he got himself hung out in no man's land. Couldn't get back, couldn't get over. He was just hung out there, and he was able to turn the corner on that one.
Gain of 7 on that play. And again, that's a good job by the defense to hold it to only 7. Here goes Doherty. Looks like he's got the first down just across the 20. Let's take a look at what's happened in this series, Kendall Lewis. In 1987, the final score, 20-14, Western Carolina the winner. They won it 19-13 in Greenville the year before that. That's the year that Bobby Doherty injured the knee. Furman a winner, 31-27 in 1985. And in that ball game, Western completed a pass to Vince Noel in the back of the end zone at the end of the game with no time left. Noel stepped out of bounds, and Furman won the ball game 31-27. And the other games, you can look at the scores, 20-19, 14-7, 17-17, 12-6. It's been that kind of a series. Little screen pass out to Bagwell. He's got it down the sideline. He'll pick up a few yards and be run out of bounds at the 16 or 17-yard line.
Furman's had great success going to the short side of the football field all day. That is away from the larger hash marks. And they continue to do this, and they continue to pick up large chunks of yardage going to the sidelines or going away from the large part of the field.
This is the 14th play of this drive by the Furman Paladins. DeBusk is changing the play at the line. Pressure coming from the backside. That should be an incomplete pass as we see flags go down and the officials indicate the arm was in the forward mode. It's an incomplete pass, but we do have flags down on the play. It's going to be holding against Furman.
And if it hadn't been holding, Craig Williamson put a lick on Frankie DeBusk. Again, Craig Williamson, he's listed as a linebacker, but he has defensive back size at 6'1", 190. So he can play in either place.
They're still discussing what they're going to do with this penalty. Western Carolina has to decide if they want third down and 6 or second down and 16. Holding, Furman. They will take the penalty. They'll move it back. So it'll be second down and 16. Furman gets another down, but they'll move them back 10 yards.
I'm not sure if that was a wise decision. Furman has been picking up the yards. If it was me, I would prefer to take the down away from them so they would have to come up with something special on third down.
I think I agree with you 100% on that one. You're giving Furman 2, possibly 3 more shots at getting the yardage. And 16 yards for the Furman offense is not that much. We have some motion in the Furman offensive line, and they're going to hit Furman with that one quickly. That's Kyle Lowry, the left tackle, a 6'3 freshman from Wren High School in Easley, South Carolina. He's the man that came up out of his stance. And that's going to be another 5-yard walk off against Furman. So all of a sudden, that call by Western Carolina is looking a little bit better and better. But Furman self-destructing just a little bit.
and it's still second and 21. And with the way that DeBusk is hooking up with Quarrel, that can be done just like that.
Checking the numbers on DeBusk passing the football, 12 of 19 for 175 yards on the day. DeBusk still has the ball. He's going to run with it. He's going to be run down and run out of bounds. And we probably ought to have a flag over there of some sort. Riding DeBusk out of bounds is Frank Garden, the defensive tackle, and he really rode him out of bounds hard.
Let me tell you, Cedric Lee put another pop on Frank DeBusk, but the problem is, again, if you're going to hit a man, you must wrap him up. Frankie DeBus took the hit, spun out, and still was able to get past the line of scrimmage.
The officials are talking over on the far side of the field. I did not see a flag come out.
That was one
but
of
it looks like we could have some kind of a call. Well, no, we're not.
That was one of those no blood, no foul calls.
Apparently so. 4:48 left to play. Third quarter, Furman 21-0 over Western Carolina. And facing a third down and 19, I think here's the time you go to the end zone and try and come up with something. DeBusk fires. Incomplete and almost intercepted by Toussaint Kennedy. It was intended for Brad Stevens, number 81, the flanker from Riverdale, Georgia. And it'll be fourth down for the Paladins.
Good idea that time by Frankie DeBusk, but the execution was just a little slow. He pulled the trigger just a little bit late, and as a consequence, he almost got the ball intercepted, and it would have been really devastating for Furman at this particular time.
A 46-yard field goal attempt coming from Glenn Connolly. All of his field goals have come this year from 40 yards or more. All of his attempts have come from that range. He's 3 of 6, kick on the way. Looks like it's got the distance. It is good. 46-yard field goal by Glenn Connolly, the sophomore from Newnan, Georgia. Furman leads Western Carolina now 24-0.
Again, Pete, an ugly drive that pays off. Furman had penalties. They had brought plays. But the mark of a good team is that they can still win. They can still be effective when things are not necessarily going well. And you can see Furman did that on this drive. So obviously they're a good team based on my hypothesis.
24-0, the Paladins over Western Carolina, and they have done everything they've had to do this afternoon.
Coach Jimmy Satterfield has to be very pleased with the type of effort that he's gotten. I'm sure there's some let down at this point, knowing that Western Carolina isn't the team such as they are. But again, Furman is still trying to score. They're still doing the things they have to do to win the football game.
The Paladins will kick off once again. It'll be Glenn Connolly that boots it away. Connolly's come on, and for the most part, he has taken those kicking chores on field goals away from Mike Wood. And when Mike Wood came on as a freshman, in his first game, he kicked a school record 51-yard field goal against South Carolina State, and everybody said this guy will rewrite the Furman record books. And as for Mike Wood, congratulations to Mike at 8 o'clock this morning, an 8-pound baby boy for he and his family. So congratulations to the Woods. Washington on the return of the kickoff out across the 25 to the 26, but a flag is down. Mike Bobrovsky making the stop once again on special teams. He's had a good day. It's a clip. It's against Western Carolina, so once again the Catamounts are pushing themselves back toward the goal line, and that's where they're going to have to start, deep in a hole, as there'll be a 15-yard mark off against Bob Waters' Catamounts inside the 15, down to the 13-yard line.
The Catamounts are a very puzzling team. They've got decent personnel, but again, they've just been outmanned today against the Paladins, because Furman is a very focused football team at this particular time.
Mark Smith has been the starting quarter, has been the quarterback, I should say, not the starter. Todd Cottrell got the start. But he's been the quarterback since midway through the second quarter. Long pass, downfield, complete to Otis Washington, and he's going to be inside the 25 to the 22. He had a half a step on Julius Dixon, and coming over to make the stop was William Hall, the free safety.
Great, great play. He went for the bomb. He was going up for it from the word go. You knew who he was going to, Otis, and he did not pull the trigger too slow. He pulled the trigger just the right time, and as a consequence, he completed the ball, completed the pass. It held up a little bit in the wind, but it was a great, great play for the Cats.
And if you can beat Julius Dixon, Jackson, you're doing a fine job with that pass. Smith now has the Catamounts in a position to do what not many teams have done against the Furman defense, and that's simply score. That ball batted away. Jeff Blankenship got a mitt up and almost pulled it in.
See, this is what we were talking about in the first half. Well, why are they trying to run? Why are they trying to run? Well, they're trying to run so Furman just doesn't tee off. Now, Furman knows they have to pass, and Furman is being very, very stingy. Granted, they completed the one pass play, but the, one game, a whole game, does not one pass play make.
This is where Furman's defense really gets stingy. Smith changing the play at the line. Now the linebackers step up into the holes, and here they come. Pressure on Smith. He heaves it up. It's going to be incomplete. Julius Dixon was chasing it toward the backside of the end zone, and he couldn't come up with it. Passing team defensively in the Southern Conference. Got two of the best against the pass today in Furman and Western Carolina. That's how they stand in the league. VMI, the league leader, but that's because, well, people simply don't pass the football against VMI. They found it much too easy to run against them. Furman, 137 yards given up defensively. Western Carolina, 152. But again, some teams have found it pretty easy to run on Western Carolina this year, and that's surprising with a 4-4 defense.
Very, very interesting statistic.
Smith looking a little bit jittery back there in the pocket. Again, he gets pressure. Brian Pitts hits him as he releases the ball. It is dropped at the 5-yard line, and it's going to bring up a fourth down against Western Carolina, and Furman's defensive pressure has turned this series around.
Yes, it has. Well, this is the same type of Furman defense that they played in the first half. The only difference is now Western Carolina is making no bones about it. We're going to come out. We're going to try to pass the ball on you. And Furman says, no, you won't either. So it's going to be interesting the rest of the way to see what transpires.
Western will go for it on fourth down and 10 from the 22.
A little swing pass would be good here.
They need something. They know a field goal is not going to be enough. Smith is back. He's in trouble. He flips it out. It's incomplete, and the Furman defense is held.
What was that? I'm at a loss for that one. There was no one but Furman ball players in the next 15 or 20 yards.
All he could do was jump it off. And nobody was there. Nobody was open. All he could do was jump it off to avoid the sack. And Furman will take over, and that defense has just been absolutely remarkable.
I think you may have just seen the last gasp for Western Carolina that time. Mark Smith is playing pretty well as a quarterback for him.
Smith has done a much better job than the starter, Todd Cottrell, but still no points on the board.
And that's where it all counts.
Up the middle for Furman as they get back to the ground game with Dwight Sterling. Sterling on the day, 26 yards on 8 carries before that one. He picked up 3 on that one. And the clock continues to tick. We're only in the third quarter, so lots of time. And you look at it, it is the third quarter. Leads you to wonder just why indeed he did go for it on fourth down. He apparently thinks his back is to the wall early in this ballgame. And I consider the third quarter pretty early. 15 minutes in the fourth quarter is a lot of time. That fumble ball is on the ground, but still, he was going to be downed at the 35-yard line. That's Greg Key, the tight end, who made the catch. And that's going to be good for a first down for the Paladins. And right now, Western Carolina wanting that fumble. It's not going to be that way, and Western Carolina's not getting any breaks right now.
Well, you have to make your breaks. They're not making any breaks. They're not making anything happen. They're lifeless on defense. They're lifeless on offense, although Mark Smith has given them somewhat of a spark. They really have to suck it up and try to get back into this football game by whatever means necessary.
Vinton Bell and Don Clardy to the near side, but they'll go up the middle with a ground game. This is Sterling. He's got another first down.
Again,
across the 45.
Great play by the bus. Fake outside pitch, handoff into the belly of the defense. He picks up about 10 yards.
There was some concern when the year started, Kendall, that Furman would not make the playoffs because they had an inexperienced quarterback. Didn't matter if they went with Baines or DeBusk, they would not have an experienced quarterback. And early in the season, it looked like that might be the case. A lot of interceptions, a lot of turnovers by Furman, but in the last two games, the Paladins have really started to come together against both Appalachian State and here today against Western Carolina. And the defense has always been good.
Well, that's what you're looking at. traditionally teams with good defenses and very strong offensive lines, those teams are there at the end of the year, and Furman has that.
Flag on the play. It's going to be against Furman. It'll negate the run by Bagwell, which didn't pick up much yardage. Again, we wait to see what Western Carolina will do. The gain was minimal, but it appears they are going to march it backwards. Holding against Furman, and that's a look from the side at Kevin Kendrick. Jeff Blankenship to his left, number 50. Ryan Pitts, number 69. A great defensive unit for the Furman Paladins. Number 72 is Paul Craven. 82 is Kelly Fletcher, the Southern Conference sack man. 9 sacks on the year. DeBusk in trouble. Look at him run away from it. Pass downfield is incomplete. Intended for Donald Lipscomb, number 25, but he was throwing on the run, and that was a tough pass to complete.
DeBusk is looking like the Southern Conference's version of John Elway, rolling out of the pocket, looking back across the field for receivers. He's doing an excellent job of being patient and making great decisions. That time he had nothing, so his decision was to throw the football away, that he did, and it turned out pretty well for Furman as they have their drive going.
Second down and 20 for the Paladins. Benton Bell goes to the left side, sophomore from Charlotte. Actually, he's a freshman. He's a redshirt freshman. Brad Stevens comes to the near side. Western Carolina stepping up defenders into the gaps, and you're going to have a sack there by Harrison. Number 98, Derek Harrison, the junior from Greenville. The hometown Catamount making the sack of Frankie DeBusk and bringing up a third down and a whole heap of yardage.
6'2", 248, great size, great quickness. He showed good quickness that time because Frankie DeBusk is very quick out from under center that time, and Derek Harrison pulled him down from the back.
And you know Western Carolina is going to be coming after DeBusk as Furman's in a must-pass situation. Third down at 23. DeBusk with one man behind him. That's Bagwell. Wide receivers to either side. And a flag. Delay of game against Furman.
DeBusk seems to be upset for some reason.
He thinks it was a quick whistle. Delay of game against the Paladins. It'll march it back 5 more. It'll be third down and 28 against Furman.
Do you notice something, a trend in the football game? Furman is getting into these very, very long yardage situations. Defensive plays by the Catamounts, mistakes by the Paladins. If this game was closer, they would be in a very bad situation because these are not the types of things that winning football teams do to contain or to maintain their momentum. And they could give Western Carolina a chance to get closer in this ballgame. I don't think Western Carolina could win it at this point, 57 seconds left in the third. All of the fourth is going. But they really have to get their game back on track here. It's been an ugly third quarter for them.
We have two penalties on this play. A delay of game against Furman and a dead ball personal foul against Western Carolina. And that's simply a penalty out of frustration on the Catamounts.
Strike all that I said. As long as Western Carolina does things like that, they're going to continue to lose this football game.
And that's going to make it a first down. An automatic first down on that play. When Western had Furman facing what would have been a third down and 28, they hand them a first down. And here they come after DeBusk, who's back to pass. Scotty Arant fights through the block of number 71 of the Paladins. That is Tom Griffith, and he makes the sack of the Furman quarterback.
Scotty Arant showing great, great quickness for one so large. Essentially, he's 280 pounds. You're looking at a young man who is 6'3", 280 pounds. He is 280 pounds, standing in his shoes, dripping wet with a rock in his pocket. And he has great quickness. He has the quickness of a linebacker, which allows them to do things on defense. He's been a bulwark in the defense today, and he, again, shows why he's one of the best defensive linemen in the Southern Conference.
And we can look at the size of this Western Carolina team. The interior line, 245, 242, 257, 239, and the linebackers, 280 and 210. Decent Southern Conference size. And we have come to the end of the third quarter of play, and Furman picks up a field goal in the quarter, and that's about it. We go to the final 15 minutes of play. Furman, 24, the Western Carolina Catamounts, nothing.
Furman lines up the second down and 20 to go. Hand off up the middle to number 30, John Agwell. He's about a yard.
Well, good hard runner off the left side. Playing with some statistics so far. Total offense for the Furman Paladins, 333 yards on the day. Western Carolina, 140, but 110 of those off the arm of quarterback Mark Smith since he came on in the second quarter.
And Mark Smith has given a boost to Western Carolina's defense and offense. Even though no points are scored, they got close. They hadn't been across the 50-yard line all day.
And 65 of those yards came on one pass play to Otis Washington. We're underway in the final period. Pete Butler and Kendall Lewis from Paladin Stadium in Greenville. And down will go Frankie DeBusk. Gina Seegers got the sack, but also had help from Gotti Arams again.
And two, the Terrell Twosome for the Western Carolina Catamounts. All conference 2 years in a row, second team. Geno Seegers, great pro size, 6'4", 238.
Punting situation for the Paladins. Back deep to receive. For Western Carolina will be Don Thomas. Low line drive kick. Good coverage by Furman, though. Sifri, reserve tight end, out to the and Smallwood also in the play.
Western Carolina is really starting to get into the game. They go in spurts. They get in and they get out of it. They get in into it and they get out of it. So it's going to be quite an uphill battle fourth quarter to make up 24 points on this great Furman defense. Although they've moved the ball between, you know, the 30 and the 50, and things have happened to stop their drive.
Big question, you wonder why they're getting to the quarterback of Furman so quickly now. The defense has done a great job recently. Third quarterback in there, so to speak. This is Otis Washington. He's got the ball, wanted to throw, but he's going to have to run, and he goes very well across midfield out of the 48.
Great play. It was a flea flicker. He didn't pull the trigger on the flea flicker, so he decided to run with the football. If he'd have went to his left across the field, he may have scored a touchdown, but as it was, he picks up about 20, 25 yards on the play.
He could play quarterback.
Yeah, he could play quarterback.
But now they've got the man back in there, Smith. You always like to see that play. Quarterback to the receiver and then pass back to the quarterback. This is Carlton Terry, and Terry is going to be close to another first down. Sherrod Weber in on the stop for the Paladins and Western Carolina. Getting something of a drive going. Looks like they're a little bit short of the first down. It's going to be second and one. Terry, a sophomore from Conway.
And they're going to the Sam White style of huddle.
Second and one.
None.
Shotgun formation. High snap. Smith gets it. Here comes Fletcher! Sack number 10 on the year by Kelly Fletcher.
Again, that was just a flat-out sprint to the quarterback. High snap, he had to handle that. Undoubtedly, that drew his attention, and it didn't draw Kelly Fletcher's attention as he just swarmed all over Mark Smith.
He's been doing that all year. As you see, Jimmy Satterfield, face of stone. No emotion on that quarterback sack by Kelly Fletcher. Another high snap, and a flag goes down this time. Smith scrambles, throws incomplete intended for Washington. It would have been good for first down yardage, but it was thrown a little bit behind Washington. But remember, a flag was thrown.
Looks like it's going to be against the Catamount.
Holding is what immediately comes to mind because of the locale of the flag. They're talking with Blankenship, and they'll get the call from him. 12:02 left to play in the ballgame. 24-0. Furman over Western Carolina. And there's a look at the Furman bench. That's Sammy Walker, a defensive tackle from Greenwood, South Carolina.
Looks like he might have a cramp in his hamstring.
Bruce Getz working with him. Fourth down and 12, and Western Carolina is going to call timeout.
That was a very interesting call there. Jimmy Satterfield decided to decline the penalty, obviously thinking that Western Carolina can't move the ball on him, so he might as well take the ball here, get good field position instead of moving their back, giving them another chance, because Mark Smith has this offense somewhat fired up and moving.
Timeout by Western Carolina, and they're going to go talk things over on the sideline. They may, in fact, change what they want to do here. They were going to go for it. 24-0 is the score. They're not totally out of it at this point, but with every second that slips away from Bob Waters and company, their chance of getting back in the ballgame becomes slimmer and slimmer. Next week, the Furman Paladins on the road again to visit the Moccasins of Tennessee Chattanooga. Buddy Nix, Western Carolina, no enviable task. They're going to be at Appalachian State, and they do indeed change their call. Anthony Bear is on to punt the football away. Now you question whether he will actually punt the football.
Well, it makes little sense to punt it at this point, 24-0. You have nothing to lose, certainly, by going for it on fourth down.
The up man, I believe, is Don Thomas. I don't think he's going to be getting the football. It comes to Bear, and he'll kick it away. Not a great kick. He just punches it down deep, and that's what he wanted to do. It'll die at the 9-yard line, and that's what he wanted to do, push Furman back deep, and he accomplished his mission. With 11:50 left to play in the ball game, the Furman Paladins have the ball back deep in their own territory, starting the drive at the 9. They lead it 24-0 over the Catamounts of Western Carolina. The attendance for today, 13,014. Good crowd on hand today for homecoming at Furman University. And the Paladins have given them everything to smile about. Here goes Doherty, cutting to the outside, now back up field. Hit once, hit twice, on his feet, and across the 20 for a first down.
Great run that time by Bobby Doherty. He just refused to go down, took a lot of hits, and gained the first down.
A 12-yard pickup by that young man, the sophomore, a red shirt.
Furman first down.
66 yards on the day. He has surpassed his game average, which was 63 per ball game. This is the fullback Sterling, and Furman going back to the running game now. And Sterling picks up about 8 to the 30. Call it 7 to the 29. And it'll be second down and 3.
You know, this is Furman football. They've got such a stable of running backs that they may as well use them. I mean, if you got them, you might as well use them, and they certainly have them.
Sterling has not had the kind of day you expected from him at tailback, but then again, he's in a totally different position now at fullback. They'll give it to him once again. Little stutter step. He's got the first down across the 35. To the 36, it'll be a first down for Furman, and Craig Williamson, the outside linebacker, makes the stop. No touchdowns on the day for Dwight Sterling, and that's something that is highly unusual. This young man leads the Southern Conference in scoring, averaging better than 9.5 points a ball game.
And this from a man who came to Greenville as a defensive lineman, interestingly.
He was a fullback when he came here, and they moved him quickly to nose guard. Here's Doherty, dipping to the outside. Again, he stays on his feet after being hit, and he gets up to the 44-yard line, 2 yards shy of a first down. Terrell Wagner making the hit and the stop for Western Carolina.
Again, these are the types of drives that we've come to get used to from Furman. These are the type of drives to beat Appalachian State. Grind it out, punishing running drives that take a lot of time off the clock.
And something to watch. You saw the lineman heading back to the huddle. That was Steve Dugan, the center, who was out leading the blocking for Bobby Doherty. There is no shortage of effort here today late in the ball game. But we're going to have that wiped off. There was a flag, and I didn't see the flag, but obviously there was one holding against the Furman Paladins. And that's going to wipe out a beautiful run by Bobby Doherty and set up a first down and 20. moving down to the 10-minute mark here in the fourth quarter. Here's Billy Stockdale, and Stockdale has been impressive on the few occasions he's had the opportunity to carry the ball.
Well, one thing about the Furman line versus the Catamount defensive line is the fact that the Catamount defense has been on the field a lot longer than their counterparts, and playing offensive defense is different, especially when you're on the field all day.
Stockdale picks up 7. 4 carries, 20 yards for Billy. DeBusk rolling right, passes out, finds his man, Bagwell, first down across midfield to the 49 of Western. And again, you saw Frankie DeBusk improvising as his primary receiver downfield was covered. He rolled out, hit the back out of the backfield, and Bagwell. And you won't find a better receiver than John. He led the team a year ago in reception.
I can't say enough about the play of Frankie DeBusk today. He's hit Bagwell on a couple of huge, huge gains. He's taking his time. He's in and out as far as his blocking schemes are concerned. He's playing very well today.
Frankie DeBusk, 14 of 22 for 202 yards. Here's Doherty. He'll be dropped for a loss of a couple.
And, you know, coming in, this is the type of game that we thought Cottrell was going to play. We thought the roles would be reversed as far as Furman running the football and Western Carolina passing it. But as it turns out, it's been the other way around. Furman passing and running, and Western Carolina doing none of it.
And with all the activities of the day, Appalachian State with the chance of upsetting Marshall, throwing the league race into a total tizzy with 4 teams now with 1 loss, if that does indeed come to be up in Huntington, West Virginia. Furman is right back in this race, and they've got the win over Appalachian State. That's going to help them. Here's the fake on the reverse. Taking a lot of folks out. Richie Harris kept the ball instead of pitching it out on the reverse to Stevens. And do we have an injured player? Harris has yet to get up. Harris has yet to get up. Derek Harrison making the tackle for Western Carolina. And the Western trainers are coming out right now to see if they can assist. There's lots of Western player that's down. Here comes Harris off the field. It's a Western player that is down. It is Derek Harrison who made the tackle.
Derek Harrison has played a whale of a ball game. He's been all over the field. He pursues well. He stops the run well. He's been he's had a couple of sacks. He's been on a couple of sacks for Frankie DeBusk. So he could just be tired, or he could have gotten dinged that time. Somebody could be ringing his room.
We just have one more game to go in the regular season, believe it or not. One more game to go in the regular season, and that, folks, is going to be a dandy. Charlie Taft will bring the Wishbone Bulldogs of the Citadel to Greenville this year, and that is going to be an outstanding ball game, without a doubt.
And as you know, the Citadel is one of the top running teams in America. So it's going to be a test of the Furman defense in the truest sense of the word, because they have a great defense against the run, and so the Citadel likes to run the football. As a matter of fact, the Citadel is number 2 in rushing offense, number 5 in rushing offense, behind Furman, who is number 2 from the Southern Conference. So you have 2 Southern Conference teams who like to do the same thing. They play the same type of football, so it's going to be a great game, and you'll see it right here on television.
2 of the top 5 rushing teams in 1AA. This game, you know, this game could conceivably take about 5 hours when Citadel comes in here if they do run the ball. But Furman has been so effective passing the football today. I agree with you. Can't say enough about Frankie DeBusk and the improvement that he has shown. And the Furman defense, 27 consecutive quarters now that they have not given up a touchdown. DeBusk fighting away. He fires back. Well,
great play. Great play, Pete.
Puts the icing on it for DeBusk.
Look at that.
He's got Southern Conference Player of the Week written all over him. And that would be the second time this year.
Again, Frankie DeBusk pressured, gets out of the pocket, doesn't cross the line of scrimmage, hits his man, John Bagwell. I think he and Bagwell have been working together all week for the touchdown. 45-yard touchdown pass. Great play.
And Wood will come on to try and tack on the extra point. Ivan Johnson will put it on the tee. They'll try and make it a 31-0 game. good. It is 31-0, and Furman continues to roll over Western Carolina in a major surprise. Nine plays, 91 yards on the drive, a lot of time off the clock, about 4 minutes, 45-yard touchdown pass, Frankie DeBust to John Bagwell. We mentioned Bagwell as the leading receiver from a year ago, and now you see why.
This young man looks like he could play split end or tight end or any kind of end that catches the football, because he's done a great job today catching the football. He's got that pass for a touchdown and two others. He's the bus go-to man in the clutch, so he's shown himself to be a very valuable member of the team, even if he isn't running the football.
Let's check once again the figures on Frankie DeBusk. He has 2 yards rushing the football, but you got to take into account the times he's been sacked by Western Carolina figure into that as well. Now, running down to the passing statistics, this is where he has shined. 15 of 23, 247 yards for that young man, and John Bagwell has just made his fifth catch of the day for 105 yards. Connolly will kick off with 7:42 left on the clock.
So what was once a beautiful day for football becomes even more beautiful. I wouldn't say beautifuler, but it's a great day for football.
It's the best weather we've had for any of our broadcasts this year. The first one we haven't had rain in. Kick goes through the end zone. It'll be Western Carolina's ball starting from the 20-yard line. Well, you know what? We told you about how Furman's offense has done this year when they've scored 21 points or more. Let's take a look at what the defense has done. When Furman's defense, since 1985, has held the opponent to 13 points or less, how's this for a record? 23 wins, no losses.
And they're 5-0 this year, Pete.
That's right. Smith throws. I think his arm was hit. The pass is going to be incomplete. It was intercepted by a Furman player. It's out of bounds, however. That's Mike Jones, I believe. No, Wade Sexton came up with the ball. Wade Sexton intercepted it, but came down out of bounds, so it'll be second down for Western Carolina. I still think his arm was hit as he went forward. The defense had good pressure on him.
This is going to be a very, very exciting 7 minutes and 35 seconds, especially if you're a Furman pass rusher, because you know what Western Carolina has to do.
Furman takes the blitz, shovel pass forward. No fooling the Furman defense, and Wayne Burr. Burr dragged him down. That was number 39, Darren Hemphill. And now we're seeing the reserves sprinkled into the Western Carolina lineup. That's the first time we've seen anyone other than Jones and Terry in the backfield for Western. Smith will throw. He fires. He finds the big tight end. That's John Reed for a first down. A gain of 15 to the 35, and Wade Sexton, the strong safety from Lake City, Tennessee, makes the stop.
So Mark Smith continues to be effective for the Catamounts, even though they're trailing 31-0. He hasn't played badly, Pete, I don't think.
He's played much better than Todd Cottrell. Cottrell just had an off day, without a doubt. Low snap, quick pickup, and he finds his man. Again, it's Reed, the tight end, across midfield of the 48. And great job by the quarterback, Smith. Sexton, again, the strong safety, has to make the stop.
First down.
Western trying to get down the field, put some kind of points on the board. Nobody likes to be shut out. Smith changing the play at the line. From the shotgun, he's going deep. Washington down there. Incomplete, almost a tremendous catch by Washington. Defensive coverage by Mike Jones, who was right with him. The ball was deflected off his hand, off the hands of Washington, then off the helmet of Jones, and finally incomplete.
Let me tell you something. Mike Jones made a great play. Instead of giving up on the ball because he thought he had defensed it, he continued to harass the receiver. Had he not done so, he would have caught the ball on his knees, falling over the 10-yard line. Another good point. Harass the man until the play is over.
Second down and 10 for the Catamounts. Quick pass out, complete. This is Hemphill. Hemphill inside the 45, down to the 43-yard line, shy of a first down. It'll be third for the Catamounts. Third down and about five.
Very curious strategy by the Catamounts. These are plays that have been open all day. They've elected to vertically stretch the field, and Furman just wasn't going to have it today.
Corey Holden may have injured his right shoulder. He's in at cornerback right now for the Paladins. Smith back, throws, hits his tight end underneath the coverage, and Reed will spin away and get the first down inside the 35 to the 32. Three catches on this drive by the tight end, John Reed, and we hadn't even called his name with the exception of one incompletion the rest of the ball game.
Short intermediate passes is what's taxing Furman's defense right now. And again, these are things that have been open all game long.
A look at the quarterback, Mark Smith, a sophomore from York. Quick pass out, finds his man. That is Schultz. Schultz makes the catch. He's a junior from Stone Mountain, Georgia, and again, Western Carolina hurries to the line of scrimmage. A gain on the play of 8 yards. Second and two.
I like Mark Smith. He looks good. Western Carolina performs well under him, at least offensively.
Cottrell's only a junior, so he's got another year to go. That's going to be a battle. Pass over the middle. It's going to be incomplete. He was intending his pass for Reed, but he overshot him. And back there was William Hall, the free safety, who stretched but couldn't come up with it. It's third and two with 5:11 left to play in the ball game, and you can see the score, 31 to nothing.
This has been an old-fashioned whipping of the truest form today.
This may be the most one-sided ball game in the history of the series. We'll have to check on that one. Smith will throw. No, it's a shovel pass, and great play by Kendrick, the linebacker. The worst whipping ever administered in this series, 34 to nothing. Furman over Western Carolina in Greenville back in 75. So close to it, but not quite right now. Another audible being called by Smith. He fires, he hits his man, and Reed drops the ball. The ball is loose, and it's going to be called incomplete. Good call by the official on the other side of the play, Kendall. The backside official called it complete. He didn't see the ball pop loose.
Well, that's just about going to do it for the Cats. You can see the non-regulars in the game for the Catamounts, almost a whole new defensive unit, except for Scotty Arant. And that's going to just about do it for this game.
4 minutes and 39 seconds left to be played. A couple of first downs, and Furman's got it put away. Patrick Baines is the new quarterback. We've got new running backs as well. I think that's Harris, the tailback. And this is the fullback charging his way off the right side. That is Ryan Sherwood.
Tackle by Scotty Arant.
Scotty Arant makes the tackle. So a totally new backfield now. Patrick Baines, Ryan Sherwood, and Richie Harris. 4 yard pickup on the play by Sherwood, who's done a good job in junior varsity games this year, but he's only been able to carry the ball 4 times in regular season play with the varsity. 4 carries, 11 yards coming into this game. And the clock continues to tick. We're down to 4 minutes left to play. Here's Harris, the junior from Savannah, up near the 35-yard line. He'll be about a yard and a half short of first down yardage.
He's got decent speed, pretty good move. He exhibited some of each on that play. Took the pitch. Instead of getting knocked down in the backfield, he gained about 3 or 4 yards on that play.
The high water mark in his career, a 100-plus yard performance in Charleston last year against the Citadel. The Citadel acclaimed Furman ran the score up, but at that point in time, Harris was the fourth team tailback, and he had over 100 yards. So much for those charges. Here goes Harris to the right side again on the power sweep. He's got the first down as he's tumbled by a couple of Western Carolina players, and he dives forward for the first down, and that is the 22nd first down of the day by Furman.
It just goes to show you what kind of stable, and you can use the word stable, of running backs Furman has, where their fourth string running back can come into a game and gain 100 yards. And every time I've seen Harris, he's done very well against whoever he was playing.
Down to 3 minutes on the clock. 31 to nothing. Furman going for another shutout. Harris, right side, bunched up in there. He fights for a couple, and that's going to be about it. The Paladins at home this year have been simply remarkable. The only thing you can say about it.
To win all of your games at home is a remarkable statistic, but then to go undefeated and unscored upon at home is very tough for your league opponents, without a doubt.
For the defense anyway, South Carolina State, shutout. Presbyterian, shutout. Newberry, shutout. VMI scored a couple of touchdowns on the offense. Their defense scored all their points. Angelo Richardson, the ball carrier that time for Furman, picking up a few. And now Western Carolina looking more and more like another shutout.
The big goose eggs.
1 minute and 47 seconds left on the clock, and it continues to tick away, and Furman holding on to the football. This has been their trademark, time-consuming drive. It's third down now, possession down for Furman. Baines will pitch it out to Harris. Harris is across the 45 to the 47, but about a yard or two shy of a first down. Gino Siggers making the tackle, and it'll be a fourth down and a punting down for the Furman Paladins, giving the ball up with less than a minute and a half to play. And we have a timeout call for as Tassant Kennedy hobbles to the sideline for Western Carolina.
The people who are supposed to be the great players for Western Carolina, the people who are supposed to come through for them, have not done so today. Gino Siggers has had an up and down social day. He's been getting blocked all day. Mr. Kennedy hasn't had a good day, nor did Mr. Cottrell have a good day.
Arant was great, though.
Arant played out of his mind, as they would say. He was a great player. He was quick. He was all over the field. And he led the defensive charge in Derek Harrison, a man who before the season and only since the spring has he been counted upon in a prominent way for the Cats. Their defense, interior defensive line, did a great job. I think it was the movement and all the different things that they were trying to do with the defense that may have thrown Seager off his game. But whatever the case was, Western Carolina just did not get the job done today.
A minute 21 left to play. Fourth down and a couple for the Furman Paladins. And we're still waiting on the punt from Bruce Like. 31-0. A dandy day for the Furman offense and the defense. Well, it's been about as consistent as they have been all season long. The only losses this year by Furman have come to two teams ranked number three in the country, Clemson and Marshall. Here's Thomas. He's going nowhere. Again, Kiernan is down to grab him by the shoulder pads and drive him to the ground. Once again, the Furman offense dominating, 467 yards in total offense by the Paladins, Kendall. They've done it again.
I would like to see Furman play Clemson late in the year down here. If the stadium was big enough, I sure would like to see that, just to see what kind of results would happen.
Well, I like when Furman plays those big teams early in the year. Sometimes they can catch them off guard or maybe before they hit their stride. Pass incomplete, deflected from the intended receiver Carlton Terry by Mike Jones. And Jones has done a good job at cornerback since coming in late in the ballgame.
But then 2 feet on the other side of that coin, Furman has certainly played better than they had earlier in the season. Clemson coming in here now, as flat as they've been playing against this Furman team, it may be a more interesting game than it was early in the year.
Clemson had Wake Forest today in Winston-Salem. And again, that was earlier today. Clemson led in that ball game. Last we heard, flag will go down. Pass out. It's going to be incomplete. Intended for the fullback, David Jones. That'll stop the clock with 54 seconds left. It's going to be a holding call against Western Carolina. And I would doubt very seriously Furman will do anything but not take the penalty and let play resume. Again, the next game for us, the 19th of November, the Wishbone Attack of Charlie Taff and the Citadel Bulldogs will come to Greenville for the regular season finale. And in all likelihood, that ball game could decide the third team from the Southern Conference that goes to the playoffs, because as it stands right now, Furman, Marshall, Appalachian State, if they defeated Marshall today, will all be in the top 10 in the country. And Citadel is charging hard. They're playing well right now.
Well, looking at the schedule, the Citadel still has a tough road to hoe because they've got Marshall and Furman left to go.
There's a shot delivered to John Reed, the tight end, by Ivan Johnson, the free safety. Reed makes the catch, and he's out to the 27-yard line. That's good for a first down for Western Carolina. And again, don't forget, December 1st, basketball, Furman Clemson from Memorial Auditorium in Greenville. That pass almost intercepted. A couple of players had shots at it, but the man that almost picked it off was Corey Holden, 6'4 sophomore defensive end from Anderson, South Carolina. And the incomplete pass stops the clock with 34 seconds left. So football against the Citadel coming up on Telecable of Greenville, 8 o'clock the night of November 19th, and then basketball, Furman and Clemson. That'll be a great one from the auditorium. The last time Furman and Clemson got together at Memorial Auditorium, it was an overtime game won by the Tigers. There's a complete pass. Andy Schultz catching his first pass of the day.
First pass complete to Andy Schultz.
Making the catch for the Furman Paladins. Number 30, Taylor Quarles. 25 seconds left to play. The officials move the sticks, and then they'll restart the clock. Pressure coming, flags are down. Smith throws, he misses his man, and again, Ivan Johnson delivers a crush to John Reed, the tight end. That's the second time he's really hammered it.
That's a hard way to make a living.
27.
10 seconds left. Was that a final I heard? 27-17, Appalachian over Marshall. That was the score. Whether it was the final or not, I do not know.
And it's at Marshall.
It is in Huntington. That was what was so amazing about it. Here comes Western Carolina, possibly the last play of the ball game. 31-0, Furman with the lead and the ball game well in hand. Smith wants to crook it downfield. He does. He finds his man Reed down to the 10. 2 seconds left. 1 second left, and they stop the clock. Timeout, Western Carolina. Well, we had to have some kind of drama today, and I guess this is going to be it. Western Carolina has a chance to put a touchdown on the board, something that hasn't been done against the Furman defense at home since way back on October 17th of last year against Appalachian State.
That's a full year ago since someone had scored on Furman at home.
24 quarters coming into this ball game. Now it's 27 quarters. Nobody scored on Furman, hasn't scored a touchdown on Furman here at home, and they'd like to make it 28 heading into that Bulldog game on the 19th of November.
So, Pete, if you had 1 second and one play, what would you call against this Furman defense? What would you do to get into
against
the end
Furman defense? I'd call it quits. I don't know. I really do not know what I'd call against this Furman defense. They have played everything so well. You've got to go to a pass. There's no doubt about that. I think I'd go to the tight end, Reed, once again. He's been the man that's been getting open on this drive. He's 6'5", 215 pounds. I think he's the man I'd have to go to. And Reed, I believe that's him lined up to the right side. It is. He's cutting across the middle. Throw over the middle. Incomplete.
Well, they gave that old college try and didn't get it in.
And Furman's defense holds off the scoring opportunity of Western Carolina. That was the only real drama we had here in the ball game today. Furman wins it by a score of 31-0. The Paladins are now 6-2 on the year. There's no jeopardy of them losing their number 10 national ranking. And there's a shot of the Western Carolina coaching staff, Bob Waters. Hand being shaken by Bobby Johnson, the defensive coordinator at Furman. We'll be back. 31-0 final score. Furman a winner.